So you put the finishing touches on your latest program, your magnum opus, and you hit compile. After some amount of time, a binary appears, and when you execute it, all is right with the world. But what actually happened here? How did your finely crafted source code become something the computer could execute? Well, let's find out. At its core, a compiler is just a program which takes source code, validates it's correct, and then transforms it into a form the computer can execute. The process of compilation can be broken down into several steps, each taking some input, transforming it, and then passing it on to the next stage, much like a factory assembly line. We're going to use C++ for this, as well as the Clang compiler, but really this is applicable to most compiled languages. The reason I'm using Clang is because it has nice options for viewing the output for each of these stages. But don't worry, I'll give you the commands you need to run if you want to try this for yourself, and I'll also link in the description to a tool called Compiler Explorer, where you can play around with this without having to install any compilers. So here's my C++ program. It does nothing useful, but it has enough moving parts for us to dissect. The first stage is called the Lexer, which scans the source code and converts it into a series of tokens. These tokens are an atom of the language and are the smallest collection of characters with some semantic meaning. The compiler will output an error if it cannot turn all the source code into a stream of tokens. And here we can see the output of the Clang Lexer. There's a few things worth pointing out here. This list is the stream of all the tokens from the program. And we can see here that each one has the internal Clang name, the collection of characters that make up the token, and the location of the token in the source code. This last one is important because it's how the compiler can tell you where in the source code your error occurred. In order for the compiler to reason about and perform operations on your code, it will convert this stream of tokens into an abstract syntax tree, or AST. This is a tree-like structure where each node represents a language construct. The parser consumes this stream of tokens and checks that it matches the language's grammar. The grammar defines the syntax of the language, and the compiler will output an error if it's not correct. For example, if an if token is not followed by an open paren token. And here we can see the output of the Clang parser. This is the AST which represents our original program.
It looks like there's a lot going on here, but we can actually see the structure of our program in here. We declare a function, which takes an argument. We declare a for loop. Inside that, we have an if statement. And at the end, we return a value.
The next stage is called code gen. This takes the AST as input and walks it to emit instructions. This is where the actual assembly for your program is created. And here we can see the output of the Clang code gen. Don't worry if it doesn't make any sense. The important thing to note is that this is the machine code representation of your program. But we're not done here yet. We cannot actually execute this, and in fact, if we try, it will complain that there is no main function or entry point into the program. So we write a quick main, we tell it about a function, we compile it, and it can't find the function. The thing is, main and foo are in separate files, and up until now, we've just been compiling one file at a time. So how do we combine all of our CPP files into one executable? This is the job of the linker. Each C++ file, also known as a translation unit, is compiled into a single object file which contains all the functions within it, but this is just a blob of assembly. The linker takes all these object files, links them together to make sure that function calls across translation units work, and produces a single executable binary. And this is how we get our final program. It's worth breaking down all these stages, because each one produces its own set of unique and interesting error messages. But if you found this video useful, then consider liking. But if you want 6 tips on how to be a better software engineer, you should check out this next video.